Spanish literature major, but I remember going to art classes with her. I did ceramic with her, and did painting with her, and I remember going to her painting class, and they were all working on these big canvases and just falling in love with art at a really young age. And my parents sort of did the opposite of most parents, and they said, please be artists, please be musicians, like, we support you, and I think this shows a testament to that, that we're all, you know, this is my sister-in-law and my brother's work, so I'm super excited about how that all came together. So I'll start with this idea of a fable. And I'll kind of come back to this throughout the lecture or talk, because I see art as investigation, as a way to figure out meaning, and this sort of idea of a fable helps me to do that in my work. So I kind of will write fables or stories or come up with narratives that kind of wraps up like my ideas or things that I've understood through my work, if that makes sense. So this is a fable that I wrote that kind of sums up my ideas around the tools that I've used in my studio. So I think I often go into the studio and see myself as the, you know, person making the work. But very early on, I have this sensation or feeling that the tools or the things in my studio were kind of pushing back on me. And so in this fable, the tools are kind of talking about themselves and saying, like, please pay attention to us. And without us, the energy in this place won't exist. So the moral of the story in this fable is to listen to the tools. And so I'm just kind of gonna give context to my work in these next few slides. So there's a fable, and then there's this idea of chromophobia that's been really important in my work. And I first came across this concept in David Batchelor's work, where thinking about color in this way, where he says that I believe it's no exaggeration to say that in the West, since antiquity, color has been systematically marginalized, reviled, diminished, and degraded. Generations of philosophers, artists, art historians, and cultural theorists of one stripe or another have kept this prejudice alive, warm, fed, and groomed. As with all prejudices, its manifest form is loneliness, fear of contamination, and corruption by something that is unknown or appears unknowable. This loathing of color, this fear of corruption through color, needs a name, chromophobia. And if you kind of look at, you know, I go into a lot of homes, and not to critique friends or family, but gallery spaces, right? The default color is white, you know, and gray, and these trends that sort of talk about color as something garish, you know, is something that I call into question a lot in my work. Here's another fable kind of addressing color, where the colors are sort of asking themselves in the studio, why do we matter? Why keep going? Why keep trying? And the color brown responded with a song, "Find me in your poop, take me by the hand, help me think what I can be like." investigation is what fuels me. Another big pillar in my work is derived from Philip Guston's writing. He talks about erasure and this idea that that there aren't accidents, and that the imagery found in the work, it can be excavated or dug up, and that the mind shouldn't take precedence, like the sort of image or mental image, but that the hand and the mind are kind of working in sync, or the hand can sort of go ahead of the mind, if that makes sense, so that you might make an image and be surprised by that image. And that's something that I've really sought out in my process and my work. I've also looked at a lot of Latin American modernist painting, and the colors there and the shapes and the forms. I'm a Colombian American, and so a lot of that painting speaks to me specifically. Also, my travels to Central and Latin America informs my work. A lot of my work is observational too, and so I use certain things to sort of speak to me or spark my interest, kind of randomly, like child drawings or, you know, there's a clown at the beach in Mexico. Something about the clothing and the colors there. I love the hand painted signs found in Latin America. Some more of that. So I was raised Mormon and have thought a lot about Mormon feminism in my work. So a lot of, for many years, I was thinking a lot about the world of visions and dreams and folklore and ritual. And in this piece there's a woman or a priestess having sort of like a spiritual experience through what these are actually stones, and they're called seer stones, which is part of Mormon folklore. So here's another piece that's related to this body of work. That's sort of depicting a dream that I had regarding my husband, where I thought he should be careful, right, while riding his motorcycle. And this idea that, premonitions come through dreams is something that I was taught at an early age. Another seer stone painting or series. So these are screenshots from video pieces that are informed by the Latin American paintings and the Mormon feminist investigations. I was also starting to sew at this time, and I come from a long line of seamstresses. A lot of my aunts and my grandmother and my abuelitas, they're all professional seamstresses. So I started to bring that into my work, and seeing textiles as a medium. So in this piece, this is my mother. So this is sort of a portrait of her, and I'm spirit medium costumes. And so I was thinking a lot about Hilma Ofman's work, where she said that the pictures are painted directly through me without any preliminary drawings and with great force. I had no idea what the paintings were supposed to depict, no matter what I worked swiftly without changing a single brush stroke. So she in essence, was working as a medium, right, channeling spirits, and the spirits were helping her make the compositions. And so I was thinking about this, but maybe sort of in a more playful way, kind of playing the role or the part of the medium with the costumes and making this imagery this way. So all these images were made during this time. A lot of these are mixed media oil. I was using oil crayons or oil paint sticks, acrylic, actual crayons, pencil. These are spirit medium ropes where people could, they're participatory, so people could come up and take them off and put them on themselves and walk around the gallery. I sort of wanted to switch gears and turn away from making so much work that directly addressed Mormon feminism, and was looking for new ways of making, and found craft theory, and this text specifically by Tim Ebel really spoke to me. He talks about material having its own force. So that goes back to thinking about tools having their own say in the studio as well. And he says that the point of art is not to reproduce the physical, but to make something visible. I also wanted to make art from a different place, a different part of my identity. And so, I thought up this persona, this ceramic crayon persona, where it was sort of like I was a ceramic crayon artist. And so kind of like this playful approach to making and kind of tapping more into that side of myself. And I thought of this person or persona as someone who thought about functional and non-functional objects and objects that sort of blur those lines. And I was thinking a lot about interior spaces, domestic spaces, starting making, just functional works. And also questioning, like I said before, the idea of white and gray being a default space. So I painted my art studio walls pink and the floors were purple. And I started making a lot of different objects all at once, and they were sort of like folding into themselves and informing the paintings, and the paintings were informing the ceramic work. And it was sort of like a world-building exercise. I also lived in San Francisco at the time, and I walked around a lot, and the colors of the buildings there were really important to me. So these are wall decor pieces. These are ceramic starting to look at craft in Colombia. And I took a trip to Colombia at this time, and in Spanish you call it artesanía, so it's sort of craft, but made for tourists, sort of like maybe in a sense sort of kitschy. This form is actually from a Sandip. I think it's Crash in English. And but to me, I thought it would be funny to use this form and make butter dishes. So have butter in it. Yeah. So here you see that I started making a lot of these butter dishes with that form. You were telling me you're interested in spoons. I really have a spoon era. And I was thinking a lot about, just functional ceramics. And maybe placing them in a specific way that suggested ritual. So these images are from my thesis show at Berkeley. That's actually a lamp. It's hard to tell, but it's a lamp in the shape of a carrot slice, and there are like holes punctured into the ceramic, and there's light coming out of it. So after graduate school, the pandemic hit and I was at home. I was a new mom and I didn't quite have the studio space set up, so I was in my living room. And so I started making a series of punch needle rugs, also thinking about them working on the wall but also on the ground. And blurring those lines between function and non-function. And these are all wool yarn. Then I started thinking about my work being instructional. I think because I was a mom and I was thinking about function, right? And so I was thinking about how work might be functional to an audience of children. And so I started using the alphabet and numbers and thinking about, well, this could live in a space where children can look at and learn from. I also started making these sort of textile pieces that looked like they could be participatory the gallery. This is sort of in that same realm of sort of costume, what I call them guanas, which are ponchos, and with the alphabet on them. So this body of work was for a show called Isla de Lechuga, or Island of Lettuce. And it's an imaginary island off of the coast of Colombia and the US. So physically impossible, but it was a way for me to really dive deeper into my biracial identity. And I thought of this place as a place ruled by children, or that children were at least equally by children, and it's a society that values childhood in a more significant way than we do. And so I thought a lot about how to make objects that come from their society, so masks and fables and functional objects. And I also was looking at taking a closer look at the craft objects from Colombia, and sort of I realized that a lot of my connection to Colombia was through these objects, because I didn't grow up going to Colombia, and these objects were in my home, and so looking at them were really like the strongest reference point that I had to this place or this land that I was from but didn't have a direct connection to. I thought about signage that could be on the walls in this imaginary island. And this says, when your abuelita flies into town, clip a feather off of one of her wings. It will work well as a paintbrush. This one says, ¿cómo te sientes hoy? How do you feel today? I thought a lot about what language these people speak, or the children speak, and thought about that they might speak in through shapes, and that the shapes don't necessarily have like a one-to-one meaning, but that the shapes are more like have like emotional significance or suggest certain ideas. A lot of the shapes are from my personal life too. Seashells, I live close to the ocean, so there are seashell shapes here. Bread here, which my children love to eat. My son's footprint here. My son's silhouette hands. And so these are called messages 1 through 10. So they're sort of messages that I'm receiving from this place. I also thought about something that my abuelito, my grandfather, told me. He's 94 now. And he told me that he had a dream that in heaven there are beautiful machines. And he was telling me, in the sense that not tethered to utility or survival. So, that brings me to the show. I was asked to be in the show by Chase Westfall, and I worked with my siblings on this. We, as stated in the statement, the works weren't made together, not in collaboration, but the ideas and themes of the show we kind of came up with together, and it was almost like a prompt. And learning about New Harmony really informed this prompt, and thinking about how this was the Utopia project twice, right? Two different attempts, really was just so incredible to us, and we thought a lot about that. And we thought about what that sort of Utopia project might mean or look like for a group of artists, and we thought of the title we wanted it to represent us as a group, so we thought we, you know, instead of me, and the three E's represents each one of us, right? And not only we, but like we. So I think Chase wrote the second paragraph here, but I really liked the last part where he says, "What happens when aspirational collectivity comes into contact with obstinate reality? Weee remains optimistic and offers positive action symbols and models for human interconnectedness." So sometimes the idea, right, is so hopeful, and then the execution that becomes problematic, right? So I think the work in the show is still in that realm of ideas. And Kiki, who is my sister-in-law, she wrote these thoughts that she had about Utopia. And I like how she said, "The deep space for newness and idealizations we hold inside of us is in conversation with the reality of the outside. It is the dusty doorway or hot window sill between the two where Utopia is felt by your hand." Almost this like fleeting sensation, right? Like something you want to grasp, but it might stay in that realm of ideas. My brother wrote, "Weee expands on ideas of hybridity, where individuality is not erased but transformed by collective experiences and context. We hope you use our works as metaphysical thread in sewing together the separation of the us and them in you." So here's an image of another craft object from Colombia that informed a lot of the pieces I made specifically. And I wanted to go through and do a walk through the gallery, if that's okay, and talk about the pieces that I made and a little bit about. I don't want to speak for my siblings in the show, but we can walk through them together, if that's okay.
Thank you.
this is called apple tomato machine. And so that the title, my son and I play these word games, and so the title came from one of those games where the mashup of those two words, apple and tomato, and what, you know, the machine referencing my grandfather's idea of machines in heaven, and then the playfulness of the mashup of the tomato and apple. And so for me, that kind of conveys this idea of like utopia being it's sort of living in the realm of ideas, and but then the physicality, or the way that we actually move in the world, kind of standing in the way of that being manifested or executed successfully, which is would be like the machine part of this piece, when machines expire, right? So these shapes kind of are informed by the Isla Chuba shapes. They're a continuation. This pretzel shape is significant to me. I was watching Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood with my son, and he went to a pretzel factory, and in the episode he says that pretzels are given to children who memorize the prayers. And I thought, how strange and interesting at the same time. And it kind of addressed my sort of questions around how to teach my children about the world and spirituality, and you know, I think so much as parents, we try to instill like a hopeful outlook of the world and life, and that sort of points to that.
So most of this be the wood, and then you use that social role in the theme.
Yeah, exactly.
It seemed like where the circles are, it looks like you're using something else there.
Yeah, so I have ceramic.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, blue. So a lot of the images I had for the Isla de la Chuga works, they're also wood and ceramic, blue ones of wood. Yeah. So I also have these takeaway zines, which you're all welcome to have. You can come up and grab one. And they're both in English and Spanish, which I'm bilingual and teaching my children Spanish. And so this is Preguntas sobre la muerte, questions about death. So my son constantly asks me about death. So this is sort of talks about, yeah, my experience as a mom and teaching them about the world and what is on their minds. And a lot of how I interpreted this prompt for the show was that so much of how we sort of explain utopia or hope is through education. So I saw my works in the show as having like an educational approach. So these are reversible. So that's the Spanish side, and then you reverse it, and you can read it in English now. So questions about death. This is a real conversation I have with my son. Does everyone have to die? I don't want to die, my son said. I said, yes, we all have to die. He said, will I be able to eat when I'm dead? He's really worried about whether or not he can eat when he's dead. And I just say, well, maybe part of you will be able to still eat.
wiping instead of cleaning, flush, and washing. So if you know a four-year-old, so. And again, a lot of these shapes come from that easy out of the Chuga body of work. A lot of these shapes came from when I was pregnant, I was bedridden. I mean, I couldn't really function. I was throwing up all day, so I couldn't go in the studio, and I was very, very frustrated. If I don't make anything, I do not feel well. And so I realized if I drew at least an hour a day, I felt much better. And so I suggest that to anyone. If you feel like you're in a funk and you can't make anything, but it's all or nothing, just do 1 hour a day. 1 hour a day, and it'll make a big difference. But so many of the shapes that come from that are in my recent body work come from those drawings. And then the last works in here, I already talked about the textile pieces, but then this last one here is another machine. I don't know if any of you are parents here, but there's a lot of sleep deprivation.
I remember that.
So yeah, I just thought a lot about the wordplay and the machine idea. I know that Kiki, she made an instructional book that addresses utopia. My brother Steven, he's really interested in psychoanalysis and studies a lot of Lacan especially. And he is doing an MFA at Columbia and also works in film. But a lot of these drawings are sort of illustrations, honestly, of concepts that he's learning about and thinking about. Concepts in psychoanalysis, especially. This is actually a puzzle here for blocks to play with. So there's a white to play with for 2 years. You can figure them out. Whatever you want, you can actually touch those. So, any questions?
So, do you have some goal ahead of time of what it should look like at the end?
No.
So it could be different for different people.
Yeah, definitely. So that's I've made a few puzzles before. That's my most recent body of work, is making puzzles for people in the gallery to use.
You've worked in so many different mediums, so do you have a preference, or does it kind of depend on where you are in your life and what you're doing?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that it really varies from day to day, even. Sometimes I feel kind of stuck working in a certain medium, and so I'll sort of put that on a certain piece or project on hold, and then work on a different medium. Mm-hmm. And they sort of, like I said before, they sort of build off of each other and inform each other. But I really enjoy working with different mediums all at once and like putting them together. And especially like learning how to use materials is really fun for me. So I think maybe paint is sort of like where my heart is. There's nothing like painting. So I think I love it all, but paint. Something about paint. Yeah. However that was, even if I'm painting wood or it looks more sculptural, but the act of like paintbrush paint to a surface is like, there's nothing like that.
Really like that fable about paintbrushes.
Oh,
so, how how did you get into that kind of creativity, mixing with the art? It's pretty neat.
Oh, the writing aspect?
The writing aspect, yeah.
Oh, that's a good question. In graduate school, I had a professor named Anne Walsh, and she really pushed us to write. And so I wrote a lot in her class, and I do have a solid writing practice. I write every single morning. I write 3 pages. I don't know if anyone has read The Artist's Way. It's like, yeah, it's mm-hmm. a great book, but she really recommends first thing in the morning writing 3 pages a day. Mm-hmm. I find like when I write, it isn't in conversation with my work, and it's a lot more successful than when I try to write about my work. If that makes sense. So the fables, it's like, I wasn't trying to describe my work, I was just writing, and somehow like what I was figuring out in my studio came up in the writing, and I really enjoy that process. But it's something I really need to explore more, so thanks for your encouragement.
I mean, the fables came out of your morning pages?
No, not exactly. I started writing in graduate school, so I wrote those. I wrote those specifically, the ones I showed in graduate school. But I really want to start. Yeah, I should start writing more than that. The morning pages. I still feel like they're more like mind garbage exercise. I can't quite get it to. Maybe someday they'll turn into something.
Have you thought about turning the Isla de la Chuga material into like a children's book?
That's a really good idea. I actually have. So Kiki and I are in a collective together. It's called Scary Sugar Collective with 2 other artists and designers. And we thought about making a children's book together. Yeah, and Kiki's an illustrator, so she thinks a lot about, books for children. And coincidentally, Stephen, a lot of these drawings, he says, are drawings for a book that's psychoanalysis for kids. So I don't know if that's sort of like an abstract concept or it's an actual thing that will happen. I haven't really gotten the details on that, but a lot of, like all 3 of us really engage. Children as an audience, I think we think about that a lot. Yeah. Mm-hmm.